How you doing, everyone? This is Flex 1296, and today we're bringing you an episode of Footie Talk. This is going to be part two of the four-part series in which I analyse the transfer window that has been and gone. So today we've got five more teams, and we're going to be looking at. Well, let's start with Chelsea first. Chelsea. You've got to imagine that Chelsea will be back in the top four this season. And that having no European football will definitely help them. You saw it with Liverpool a few seasons ago, how they came close to winning the Premier League with no European football and such a small squad. I feel like Chelsea can recreate that. Probably challenging for the league as well. Getting into top four will probably be very, very likely. But challenging as well for the title will also probably be a possibility. So go imagine that will happen. As far as incomings and outgoings, the one deal that shocked me most, or shocked everyone, because it kind of came out of the blue, I guess, is the David Luiz deal that happened on deadline day. I don't think no one saw his return coming. I think, is it a good deal for Chelsea? If he's matured in France, maybe. But if he hasn't, and he's still making the same mistakes that saw him leave Chelsea, it could be very, very dangerous as far as Chelsea are concerned. Because, let's face it, he is a good player. Let's not... Was he worth 50 million when he left? No, Chelsea got a good deal from that. But he is a good player. He can play in midfield as well as attack. He can... he's a good striker of the ball for a centre-back. We've seen him score some memorable goals in the Premier League during his first spell at Chelsea. And he's got some pace about him, and he is actually very good at reading the game, but he's sort of good at, he's basically good in the air, isn't he? He's good in the air in both areas, so it's not a bad signing for Chelsea. It's just if he can stop with the constant mistakes and being caught out of position, then maybe it will be a good signing for Chelsea. But Chelsea are a team that has spent very good in this window. They've spent on Luiz, like I just mentioned. They've also spent on Alonso, a left-back, which I did think they needed a left-back. And not only that, but they've signed a young Belgian striker in Batshuayi. A lot of potential. Another Belgian striker. Welcome to the Premier League. Saw him in the World Cup. Not World Cup, the Euro, sorry. Very little. But the little you did see of him, you could tell there was something there. Right move to go to Chelsea. I guess so, because they have only got like Costa now. So as a well known striker, so it is a good move for him. But the biggest deal before the Luiz deal. Was the signing of N'Golo Kanté from Leicester City, the champions of last season. Very, very good signing for Chelsea. As mentioned before, I didn't quite get the transfer on Kanté's part. But for Chelsea, it's an incredible signing. And this is someone that they need because since probably Makalele, they haven't had a midfielder that has wanted to not to really get forward as much and score the goals, but more become like a ball-winning kind of midfielder. Become the guy that can put a foot in and can break up play and then dictate the tempo at Chelsea's own pace. That is exactly what they've got in Kanté. That's exactly what they've needed, and they've spent well in getting him. So, they've spent really well, and as far as outgoings, there's a lot of loans again. There is a lot of loans from Chelsea. I won't go through them all. But they've sent a lot of youngsters out on loan. They're all in different places, so they'll get used to different styles of football, which I believe to be very good for the future for Chelsea, depending on how much time and effort is going to be spent into gaining these players' development. And it's not just a placeholder kind of thing for any potential deals in the future. Next, move on to Crystal Palace. Obviously, we all know their problem. Their problem was they don't get enough goals. And they have now signed Benteke and Remy. Remy's on loan. Benteke was the £32 million deal from Liverpool. Two great strikers. I always think that Remy's only problem was is that he was quite injury prone at both Newcastle and Chelsea. But when he was given the chance, 9 times out of 10, he did score goals. Benteke's problem was that he didn't fit into the Liverpool system. And I don't think he would have fit into Brendan Rodgers' system either. Even though he says that if Brendan Rodgers had stayed at Liverpool, that he probably would have been a success. I don't believe that because it's both managers play a particular style and that style doesn't match up to Benteke's strengths. Yes, Benteke does score plenty of goals in plenty of different ways, but at Aston Villa, his main area of attack was heading the ball and playing more direct up to him. Liverpool didn't do that, which is why he was rendered a failure. And it's not the case. He's still a great striker. It's just that we didn't play the way he wanted to play, obviously. Did Palace play that way? They've got to start getting crosses in the box. If they want to get goals out of him, they've got to play to his strengths. And that means playing the ball up long, direct to him. And for Remy, he can use his pace. He's quite the, I would say, advanced kind of forward in that he likes to play on the defender's shoulder, the last defender's shoulder. But he has got plenty of pace, and I do believe that to be a great loan signing as far as Crystal Palace is concerned. They also signed Mandanda, a goalkeeper, and Townsend, who, a lot of pace about him. He's a player that kind of can frustrate you at times because I believe him to be a bit ball greedy, but sometimes he can produce some great stuff as well. You know, when the ball is at his feet, he's got a good long range shot on him with either foot. He's pacey, he's quick, he's skillful, and I believe him to be a good signing. And is he a replacement for Yannick Bolasie? Maybe not, but at the same time, I do believe that, and that's kind of a good segue actually to outgoings. I do believe that to be a kind of a good deal as far as Palace were concerned. For Bolasie, selling for £30 million. Dwight Gale for £10 million, and also McCarthy and Yedinak were also out the door as well for Palace. Bolasie was always going to be difficult to keep hold of because he's always been a guy that's on his form, on his day. He can be really, really unstoppable. But when he's not, it's sort of like Palace don't have another sort of option. He doesn't probably get enough goals for my liking, but it's still a good signing for Everton and a big miss for Palace. But they couldn't do anything about it, and that's why he's currently at Everton. Next, move on to Everton, which again, another good segue. Bolasie, who we've just been talking about, £30 million signing. Ashley Williams, who I think is a great signing and a good replacement for John Stones. He's basically been Swansea's Mr. Reliable. And he's been the guy that's been Swansea's most consistent player in no matter what league they played in his time being there. He's always been there, he's always been consistent. And I believe, was it probably the right time to move on? Probably. And at the same time, it's a great signing for Everton. They also signed Stecklenburg from Southampton, a goalkeeper. They did need a goalkeeper since Tim Howard has gone back to America. And not only that, but they have also got Ena Valencia on loan. Again, they did need a striker because Lukaku is basically their only striker. They may have... Well, they're only striker of a clinical nature, who can get them plenty of goals. Valencia can get plenty of goals. I still believe there's more to come from him from his time at West Ham, but I don't know. He's got pace. He's got strength. He's a complete striker. He's got all round ability, and he'll be a great addition to this Everton side that Ronald Koeman is trying to build. Outgoings, the only one of real note, again, John Stones, the £50 million defender that we've already talked about. Again, it was always going to be difficult keeping him because he's a young English prospect. Man City came in with a bid. They accepted. They got £50 million for it. And only time will tell how he progresses at Man City. But the good thing on Everton's part is they replaced him with a decent defender in Ashley Williams. Let's go with Stoke. Stoke, very unlucky, I believe, last season to not qualify for Europa League. I do believe that injuries played a massive part in them not getting that European football spot. So what do? They go and they sign some decent players to help them boost their chances this season and obviously help with possibly the amount of injuries that they mounted up last season. Joe Allen from Liverpool for £14 million. Good signing. I do believe we didn't see enough of Joe Allen at the beginning of his Liverpool career, and then last season he became sort of like an unlikely hero. And he just became loved amongst Liverpool fans. But I just think maybe it was the right time for him to go. I don't believe he would have got much first team football, which is the reason why he said he was leaving in the first place. So I think Klopp was right in that respect to get rid of him if that was the case. And then obviously on the final day of the window, they signed Wilfred Bonny on loan, and as well as Bruno Martins-Indy on loan. Martins-Indy, a centre-back, which was good because they went on to loan out Philip Walshide. Moments later after the deal was confirmed. So it was a good kind of trade in that respect. Don't know much about Martins-Indy, but I'm sure I'll find out about him more as the season goes on. And Joe Allen, obviously. I already mentioned him, but I didn't mention him enough. Joe Allen, very good signing. Keeps the ball well. Does the simple things. And will also look to break forward. And Wilfred Bonny, if he can recreate the form he showed at Swansea, Stoke have got a really good goal scorer on their hands. And with the kind of flair players around him, like Shaqiri and Arnautovic and Bojan, he really should get plenty of chances. And again, if he can put them away, Stoke may have a chance at potential Europa League football this season. I know it hasn't been a great start for them. They have had a tough start, but if he can put away them chances, then Stoke will have no problem in breaking into the top seven at least. They can definitely do that. I've got no hesitation on that. Finally for this part, Tottenham. Tottenham Hotspur, last year's third place team. Had a good season, just fell at the final hurdle once they realised that catching Leicester was impossible. So they regrouped, redeveloped, and refocused, I guess. They went out, they bought Victor Wanyama from Southampton. Good signing. I do like Wanyama. I do think that he's a kind of perfect midfielder in that he's good with the ball at his feet. He's good at making a challenge. And he'll basically do... And he's got good stamina as well, which obviously will make him last the full 90 minutes. And I just believe that's to be a great signing as far as Tottenham are concerned. And he'll definitely do a job in that midfield role for when Dembele isn't there, for when Dier may not be there. Vincent Janssen, very good start for his Tottenham career. He's already proved to be a good signing as far as they're concerned. He can probably only go up from here. Like, he's still obviously got a lot to prove. He hasn't done anything incredible yet, but he's basically gone in and he's done a job, and that's all you can ask of him, really. On deadline day, Tottenham made two signings. The very, very late signing of Moussa Sissoko was one of them, as well as, is it Kelvin Nkodu? I believe that. But the Sissoko deal was very strange because it did look like Everton was going to sign him. And then from... I mean, Tottenham had already announced their interest in him earlier that day, but they called off their interest. And then it looked as if... Everton were going to sign him. And then Tottenham came in, they matched the deal, and then Everton pulled out. So... it was a very strange end to deadline day, but for Tottenham, 30 million for Sissoko, he'll definitely challenge Lamela for starting place. He can also play on the opposite side. And for a while, he did actually play through the centre, so he's definitely versatile in that respect. But the only problem is that he didn't turn up at all for Newcastle season last season. And he played very well in the Euros. But it depends what kind of Sissoko turns up, because if he's going to be the one that was vacant all season during Newcastle's relegation season, then... It's gonna be 30 million not well spent. But if they can get the Sissoko that was there during the Euros and that did an amazing job for France, then maybe, just maybe, this 30 million pound deal could be a great signing. And also, it shows that Tottenham are going for great squad depth with them having Champions League football this season. There wasn't many outgoings, but there was a couple. Ryan Mason to Hull for £8 million, a good deal for Tottenham, I think. I don't think Mason showed enough. He had a good start to his Tottenham senior career. Slightly fizzled out once he wasn't getting a starting place. But I do believe it to be a good signing for Hull. And a good sell for Tottenham. And Nasser Chadli to West Brom. Chadli lost his way in the team thanks to Dele Alli coming to fruition. And Christian Eriksen. So he sort of lost his way in the team. And going to West Brom will definitely guarantee him to have a starting run, basically. So this is part two. Part three will be coming up soon. Thanks guys for listening. and I will see you on the other side.